So I suggest in the Lowell Health Code Nutrition Guide to aim to have about 40 to 60% of your energy from your diet coming from fats. And those are going to be healthy fats coming from avocados, olives, olive oil, nuts, seeds, salmon, those types of fats that come from nature. That is one of the things that you can really rely on in order to tell if something is a healthy fat or a harmful fat, is if it comes naturally in nature. Fats that are naturally occurring in nature, say they come from fish or eggs or avocado, something that is grown naturally, as opposed to a fat that's manufactured in a factory only by humans. So there's no such thing in nature as canola oil, soybean oil, corn oil, safflower oil. Those things do not exist in nature. They take a chemical process in a factory in order to make them into an oil. These types of fats are already damaged during that factory processing, and they're actually super harmful to your body. So they get incorporated into your cell membranes, and they can get incorporated into the tissues on the surface of your skin and cause premature aging. Once they get incorporated into these cell membranes, they can cause all sorts of issues for your cells. Inside of those membranes, they can disrupt cell signaling, they can cause leaky gut issues, they cause inflammation at the gut lining, they cause all sorts of issues like IBS and Crohn's. And so we really want to make sure that we're decreasing inflammation rather than increasing inflammation in our body in order to help our body balance that oxidative to antioxidative threshold that it's always trying to counterbalance. One of the really great things about having a high fat diet is the anti-inflammatory effect that it has on your entire body. So when your body is making energy in the form of ATP from glucose, it makes a certain amount of oxidative free radicals as a metabolic byproduct. And this is very normal. This is what happens when we take food and oxygen and we convert it into energy. It happens every day for us. The body has a certain amount of capacity to be able to fight these free radicals, neutralize them, and remove them from the body. When the body converts fat into energy as ATP, it goes through a different metabolic pathway. It actually produces less oxidative free radicals than the glucose pathway. And this creates an overall lowered load of oxidative free radicals that need to be neutralized within the body, which means that converting fat into energy is a more anti-inflammatory way of eating. So if the body has less inflammation that it needs to combat from just regular metabolism, it can go about its business and it can divert its attention to other things throughout the body that might need attention. So this is another way that having a high fat diet is health promoting, which is really great because, as we know, inflammation is at the root cause of all chronic diseases such as heart disease, diabetes, dementia. So if we're able to decrease that inflammation, the better off we're going to be from a health and longevity perspective. Another tip that I have for you guys about fasting is not to punish your body with fasting. So if you have had a weekend where maybe you were drinking, or you had less than ideal foods, or you had some foods that didn't agree with your system and you really want to hop on the health bandwagon, say Monday after your weekend, my suggestion would be to just have a normal eating day first before you jump right into fasting. If you jump right into fasting right away, your body is not going to be as efficient at upregulating those pathways. It's gonna have some insulin resistance hanging around from alcohol consumption or poor sleep, and you won't be able to digest your food the way that you normally would. So my suggestion would be for on Monday to just have a regular diet where maybe you're doing some 12-hour time-restricted eating over nighttime, you're having a high-fat protein, and maybe you want to do a ketogenic breakfast if you want to, and then just eat normally as you would, having whole food meals throughout the day as you get hungry. And then starting your fast after dinner that night, making sure you have a whole day of normal eating in order to regulate your metabolism. And then if you want to go ahead and engage in some intermittent fasting again the next day after you've regulated your body, then you can go ahead and do that. Another tip that I have around alcohol is that I'm a lot more sensitive to both alcohol and caffeine after starting to incorporate intermittent fasting into my lifestyle. I find that if I have too much caffeine during the day, it really affects my hormones and my ability to get to sleep that night. Even if I have like a cup of green tea after say like 12 or 1 p.m., I find that it's pushing back my bedtime. And because my goal is to have circadian sync time-restricted eating throughout the day, I really want to make sure that I'm not pushing my bedtime back too late. Then I've found that I also have to be very conservative with my alcohol consumption because I just can't tolerate alcohol the way that I used to be able to. And because the composition of my diet, where it's mostly made up of fat, I find that my meals are not able to counterbalance the alcohol like you normally would if, say, you had like a high carb meal. So just be careful around alcohol consumption and caffeine. One of the things that happens when you have too much caffeine is that it affects our hormones. You've probably heard of adrenal health, but your adrenals are those little glands that sit on top of your kidneys, and they release cortisol and a whole bunch of different types of stress hormones. And those are important because those affect our metabolism. So when we release stress hormones like cortisol, it actually causes insulin resistance. That's our body saying, hey, we're in a fight or flight mode. We've got more important things to worry about than digestion right now. So we're going to shut that down, and we're going to focus our energy on our central nervous system, making sure that we're getting enough blood to our heart and our brains. We can make sure that our human is able to operate in a fight or flight situation. This is something that people talk about all the time when they're talking about chronic stress. You want to make sure that you're being mindful of your caffeine take so those aren't affecting your stress hormones. Not only do stress hormones cause insulin resistance, but they can also cause our body to break down protein even when it's not needed. So when your body goes into this fight or flight mode, your body's like, okay, I need to make sure that I have enough blood. I need to make sure I have enough energy. So it's going to go ahead and it's going to break down some of your lean muscle mass in order to create energy for itself. It's called gluconeogenesis. So we don't want to be stimulating our body to do all these unnecessary actions that we actually don't need just because of chronic stress. So we want to make sure that we're really taking care of our adrenal health and our hormone health in order to help our body metabolize the way that we want it to. Another question that I also get a lot is about what you can eat when you're fasting. So really the simple answer is you can eat anything that isn't going to affect your blood sugar. And the only thing that doesn't affect your blood sugar is fat. So any other macronutrients that you include in your diet, carbohydrates or protein, are all going to increase blood sugar levels and therefore insulin levels. While you're fasting, you're going to want to prioritize fat. Not only is fat satiating, it's going to help ward off hunger hormones, but it's also going to help you fast for longer periods of time. Not only that, but fat is also going to serve as a fuel source for you. So you're still going to be able to give your brain and your body lots of really good quality energy, even though you're not eating, which is ideal when you're going to be fasting for longer periods. Another thing that I wanted to mention is longer 24-hour fasts. So 24-hour fasts are something that I've really enjoyed incorporating into my time-restricted eating schedules. And one of the reasons why I like doing this is because it really helps build up that metabolic flexibility. So I find that after I do a 24-hour fast, doing something smaller like a 12 to 16-hour fast is way easier for me because my body is just so much more used to using those pathways. So I really like to do it for those reasons, as well as increasing stimulation of autophagy. So as I mentioned before, autophagy is this cellular repair and maintenance process that happens where we're breaking down all these old proteins and dysfunctional cells when we're fasting. So doing longer fasts, such as a 24-hour fast, really stimulates autophagy and is really helpful for decreasing inflammation and decreasing your risk factors for chronic disease. A lot of research supports that doing a 24-hour fast is the most effective way to regulate your blood sugar levels, regulate your A1C levels, reverse your diabetes, increase your insulin sensitivity, and decrease your cardiovascular risk markers, which is insane. We've never been able to implement a therapy this effective for something that covers such a broad range of chronic diseases. That's why I'm so hooked on time-restricted eating, because the benefits of time-restricted eating keep on piling up. I just love that we're able to combat these diseases with such natural remedies rather than using pharmaceuticals. Okay, so one of the questions that I wanted to address that I keep on getting asked is, should I work out when I'm fasting? And the answer to that is yes, absolutely. Definitely keep on working out when you're fasting. You really shouldn't change your lifestyle at all when you're fasting. Once you get better at fasting, it usually takes like 6 to 8 weeks to build up the cellular machinery that you need to upregulate those pathways in order to seamlessly switch in between glucose and fat burning. But once you do that, you really shouldn't have to alter your life at all. One of the things that I usually do is that when I'm having a heavy resistance training day or weightlifting day, I usually try and not do too long of an extended fast on that day. And that's just because I want to make sure that I am getting enough time in to nourish my body and give it enough protein in order to rebuild those cells. But like I talked about before, fasting releases hormones that promotes muscle preservation. So you're not going to get that breakdown of muscle tissue if you don't eat and continue your fast after, say, your AM workout. What I would suggest is making sure that you're cognizant of having really high quality protein once you do start eating again. One of the benefits of having high quality protein in your diet is that it's really satiating. So I love adding high quality protein into my meal directly after I finish fasting because I'm making sure I'm replenishing my muscles, making sure my immune system gets all the protein proteins that they need, making sure all my organs get all the proteins that they need. And I'm also eating a really satiating meal, especially when you combine high quality fat and protein together. And that way you're gonna be super satisfied. You're gonna suppress all of your stress hormones. You're gonna feel really relaxed and your whole body is gonna be nourished after this period of fasting that you just did. And if you're interested in losing weight, extending your fast past that 12-hour period into a 24-hour period is a really great way to accelerate fat loss. Not only that, but exercising while fasting is another way to accelerate weight loss. So if you're looking to get rid of some excess weight, all you have to do is practice time-restricting eating overnight, I would say a minimum of 12 hours, and then workout fasted in the morning, whatever type of workout you wanna do. And then whenever you're feeling hungry again, have a high-fat whole foods breakfast and you'll be good to go. So in general, I would say you don't have to adjust your workout schedule to your fasting schedule. But another thing that I might want to mention is that you want to be aware of not overtraining as well. Even if you aren't fasting, you don't want to be lifting weights or doing HIIT workouts or doing CrossFit workouts 5 days a week. That is just way too much stress on your muscles and it's not able to recover in time in order to keep building muscle tissue. Not only that, but that's going to create a surplus of inflammation in your body that it's not going to be able to keep up with. So I usually recommend weight training like 2 to 3 days a week or HIIT training 2 days a week because you really need to give your body adequate rest in between those sessions so that it can really recover and you can gain the benefits of that weight training session. Other than that, making sure that you stay active. I like incorporating weight training, high intensity, and low intensity training in order to build muscle and burn fat. And then other than that, I just stay active. I try and walk as much as I can. I take the stairs, I walk to the grocery store. And I'm making sure that I move my body every single day, even if it's just a quick stretch before work. A lot of the times I work really long hours. I'm out of the house for like 13, 14 hours. So I'm not gonna be working out on those days that I work those really long hours. We wanna make sure that I try and get a little bit of natural light on my skin and in my eyes each day, doing a little bit of movement, getting some stretching or walking in to make sure that I'm moving my body each and every day. So when you first start fasting, you really wanna make sure that you are listening to your body. So say you decide that you wanna do a 16-hour fast and an 8-hour eating window, and you get to like the 12, 13, 14 hour mark and you are starving. My advice to you would be to go ahead and eat. Make sure you're having a high fat, whole foods, nutrient dense meal in order to regulate your blood sugar and your hunger hormones rather than trying to will yourself to hold out till that 16 hour mark. The reason for that is like I talked about before, if you are super hungry, you're gonna be releasing those stress hormones from your adrenals. This is gonna work against you from a metabolic perspective. So your body is not gonna be able to convert fat to energy as easily as it did before, and it's gonna start breaking down protein for energy. So what you wanna do is just go ahead and eat. The only time that you wanna continue your fast is if you're not feeling famished. If you feel good, if you're still high energy, you still have good brain function, go ahead and continue your fast. But as soon as you start to feel famished, low energy, like you're super hungry or starving, go ahead and just eat. You wanna break your fast, give your body what it's asking for, and then you can either have just like a regular day the next day with like a 12-hour eating window overnight and have regular meals throughout the day, or you can again go ahead and try to have a tighter eating window again the next day if you want to continue doing that. The only thing I do want to suggest is to alternate your days. Making sure that you're not doing too many fasting days in a row is going to help you gain the most metabolic benefits from this eating pattern. You don't want to be like, hey, I'm getting really good at it. Let's just do it every day and let's do 20-hour, 24-hour fast every day. That's not how it works. You want to be giving your body the counterbalance of those stresses that you're putting on it in order for them to benefit from it. So have a fasting day, non-fasting day, or have 2 fasting days, 2 non-fasting days. You want to make sure that you do that cyclical process that I was talking about before in order to gain the most metabolic benefits as well as the most anti-aging and longevity benefits. One thing that I wanted to mention about diet composition is that you really want to be eating the right amount of protein. Your body thrives on just the right amount of protein to maintain and build lean muscle mass, and you don't really want to be eating more than that, and you don't really want to be eating less than that. So in our Lolo Health Co nutrition guide, I've laid out a calculation that is almost twice that of the RDA recommended by Health Canada, from the research that I've done, to be an optimal protein level. So the RDA set out by Health Canada is really a level to help prevent disease, and I think that it's much lower than what we actually need. But at the same time, I don't recommend a high protein diet either. So what you really wanna get is the right amount of protein for your body. Obviously that ideal protein amount is gonna vary between men, women, your muscle mass, your activity levels, all those things. But for now, I just wanted to point out that having more protein isn't necessarily better, and let me tell you why. So the body really thrives on having either fat or carbohydrates as their energy source. Protein is super important because we need it to build all the different types of tissues in our body, but having too much protein and having to convert that protein into energy is a much more expensive energy-wise, and it creates a lot more metabolic byproducts in the process. So not only are we having to clean up more after that process happens, but it's also costing us more energy. So it costs our body less energy if we use carbs and fat for our energy sources instead. So what we really want to be doing is getting enough protein in our diet in order to cover maintenance of our muscles and tissues and to sustain protein synthesis and muscle building, and then cut it off there. We don't want to be having a super high amount of protein in our diet so that our body is being forced to convert that extra protein into energy. So once you have your diet being composed of your 40 to 60% fat, then you're gonna calculate the right amount of protein that you need for your specific body and activity levels. And then after that, the rest of that is gonna come from carbohydrates. And this is why I personally don't follow a ketogenic diet, because I think it's really important to get some extra carbohydrates, especially from non-processed, slower carbohydrates that are digested slowly and don't release those sugars as quickly into our bloodstream, and use that as a source of energy as opposed to using protein. And another benefit, like I mentioned before, is that those carbohydrates are really good for our gut bacteria and the integrity of our gut lining. So not only are we able to efficiently use those carbohydrates as energy, but we can also make sure that we maintain healthy digestion at the same time. Another thing to note about having a high protein diet is in that process of converting protein into energy is a higher inflammatory process. So like I talked about before, with carbohydrates and fats being different in their conversion to energy, protein also causes more inflammation in the body when converting it to energy instead of using it for its amino acids to build different tissues. Not only that, but the body also thrives in these high and low protein states that I was talking about before. So just like our body loves having both fed and fasted states, it also loves having both high and low protein states. So if you're continuously eating a high protein diet and not utilizing time-restricted eating, you're likely going to run into some issues with cellular dysfunction and inflammation issues down the road. So I really like to make sure I'm getting the right amount of protein, lots of fat, and then the remainder in carbohydrates. All right, guys, I hope that that wasn't too much information for you guys. I know it's a lot. There's so much to understand in this field of research. I'm super excited about all the really good evidence that is coming out of it, because I really feel like fasting and time-restricted eating is our best therapeutic intervention that we can give to people in order to combat chronic disease. Guys, if you guys have any further questions, feel free to reach out. I love talking about this kind of stuff. I'm always happy to answer your questions. Go ahead over to our Instagram page. There's lots of more information on fasting on our website as well as our Instagram. There's a lot of really great high-fat whole food recipes on our website at lolohealthco.com, as well as Lolo Health Co is going to be coming out with 3 ebooks that are going to be a wellness guide, a nutrition guide, and a grocery shopping guide. So we're really excited about putting those out. It's just getting put into ebook right now. That information will really provide all the really good details that will round out all this information that I gave to you in this video today. So make sure you go ahead and follow us on Instagram, because that's where we give most of our updates about what's going on our website. And go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel, because it really helps us bring you guys really great content like this. Let us know in the comments below what you guys are interested in hearing about. That way we can make more videos that are tailored to what you guys are interested in. Go ahead and hit that notification bell so you guys are notified anytime we post a new video. Or you can also sign up for our newsletter at lolohealthco.com. Thanks, guys.